Ja. I don't trust this.
Honestly, neither would I, but I'm putting forth the effort to put all of my shit away. Except for
Okay,
what
fair
I'm.
enough.
Like, I'm bringing torches and melons so I can eat and see if I end up in a cave.
So no armor, anything like that, right?
Oh no, I got no armor or anything.
Okay.
My beard's gone, but the color of my hair changed. What the fuck? The hell was I gonna grab? Oh, I was gonna write down the coordinates for my base.
Damn, bro, I'm gonna have to make it all the way fucking back here without any weapons or anything else. Motherfucker. This guy.
Fuck
This
is a
fucking
notebook? I
guy.
know I. Dude, I had plenty of them. There's one. God damn.
She said melons and torches.
That's what I'm bringing with me that isn't being traded.
Interesting. Where you going, pupper? Stay. Fine. So it's 600, 600, right?
Yeah.
Okay, that won't take very long. Although, you know what? I think I know which way I'm going anyways.
Unless you can come up with some coordinates that work better for you.
That'd give you a general area. That way I know how close or how
Oh,
far you
that's a
are, sir.
thing right outside my door.
What's a thing?
I'm not gonna tell you because that might give it away just a little bit.
You right. You right. Is it an Enderman, bro? Ow.
Yeah. Yeah, it was a fucking Enderman, alright.
It was definitely an Enderman. 100% Enderman.
Kinda hard to mistake an Enderman.
True.
All right,
And
600, 600. Oh, this is gonna take me a minute.
why though? Did you grab the goods? I want those.
Yep.
I want those crystals.
They're not crystals, they're amethyst blocks. I didn't end
Bro,
up getting
I
much
don't care.
crystals,
I can
but
turn them into crystals.
fair enough. I'm bringing a full stack.
That's fine. I'm okay with this.
And 18 redstone, as we agreed.
Yes. I have 26 iron. I hope you're happy.
That sounds good to me because I've got none. What little bit of iron I did have, I used on a pickaxe, which broke. Like, I didn't even get to finish mining all the amethyst with it.
I went the wrong direction, hold on.
That's okay, I'm still working my way over there. Wait,
Bro.
did I... 600 negative 600. Just so that I'm not running halfway across the fucking map.
You are way
Sorry.
Too... Way, way... Way, bro. Way. Way. All I can say is way.
No, because I think for like 600, 600, I'd have to run past your fucking base. Which I'm sure you don't want.
I just want you to know, I am bringing bones with me in case I see a dog on the way.
That's fine. As long as you don't sick it on me, I think we'll be alright.
I think we'll be okay. I think we'll be okay. You stabbed me in the back, I swear to God, it is war.
No,
war.
I promise you, dude, I got no fucking weapons. Like, I've got torches
no.
and watermelon, and that's the only two things on my hotbar.
I got torches, watermelon, and the iron, bro.
Do you want a dog? Because there's a few over here by me.
There's some over here by me, I'm just curious if I can find different ones on the way.
Alright, because these are, like, these are brown dogs.
Shut up, demon.
Yo, that wasn't even a racism, the fuck?
No! No, just shut up, demon. Just shut up, demon.
Okay, shit.
You don't know. You just don't know, bro. You don't know why it's so funny, but it's okay. You can continue to not know.
Okay.
I would like you to continue to not know. Man. Fuck. Bringing a fishing rod.
Alright, I'm almost there.
So, 600 negative 600, right?
Yeah, 600 negative 600. That way I can avoid your base, you can avoid mine.
Okay. I see. Yes. I see tree. I see skies are pink. Red trees too. Dirt that is blue. And a bone that is yellow. And I think to myself, my screen's fucking broke. Bro.
I should have known that's where this was going.
Bro, you should have. I got flowers. Taking the flowers. They're mine now.
Alright, there's 600. Now I have to go straight this way. Alright.
Hello.
Hi. Here you go. And here you go.
Did I throw it to you? Oh fuck, I accidentally picked it up. Hold on. There.
Thank you. You're good welcome. Luck to ye.
Thanks, I'll need it to get back. I didn't write down my coordinates.
Do you want me to give you a general range?
Of my coordinates?
Yeah, I know it's like 500 or something like that is general range.
I'm pretty sure you live in my backyard, bro.
No, I don't.
I see you going underground right now. I can see your name tag,
dude,
down there.
I,
you're
I'm not gonna
far
lie
from
to
me.
You. I deadass. I thought about building near you. I thought We're about allowed... building under you, but I didn't want to.
We're not allowed to alliance, bro. I'm sorry.
We can use teamwork. We just can't be on the same team if you're on a team with Rose. Like, we can call a truce and, like, go on a fucking mission or some shit together.
Yeah, but I still wouldn't trust you enough to fucking give you, like, show you, like, my base and everything in it.
No, that's fair. That's why I only, like, I disabled my entire fucking hub when I, or HUD, when I showed you my base.
Bro. Do you know what the sketchiest part is? Since I stream this, I never know fully if you're just gonna look and be like, hmm.
No.
Damn, bro. You can't watch my Minecraft streams anymore. What the fuck? Oh, fuck. That hurt.
Nope. I can't. I mean, I could if you wanted to disable your coordinates, but that's about it.
I mean, I can.
But, like, I'm not, you know, I'm not gonna use your fucking stream to track your ass down.
Like some other people do?
Yeah.
Shout out, like, to Jeb the Carrot, by the way.
He's Son one that does.
Oh, he definitely does. He does, and I fucking call him out for it all the time. I'm like, stop being a bitch, and then I kill him anyways.
Fuck, man, I'm just trying to get back to my base, you assholes.
That's real. I feel that.
Yeah,
it's
me too.
It's nighttime,
you know
so
what
I can't
else
see
I feel?
Shit. What?
A bunch of arrows in my ass. That's what I feel. God damn it.
I just fell. So fucking far.
Same. Mine was because I tried to jump to a tree and a zombie was right there to beat the piss out of me.
Mine was because I fell into a fucking ravine and almost died. God damn, this game hates me. I'm just gonna stay down here tonight. That sounds like a good idea. I'll wait. My bad, slime. I'll fucking wait.
Oh, I made it home.
I didn't. I'm stuck in a hole. You ever just eat something and the sound effect doesn't play and you're kind of disappointed? You don't hear that.
No. But it seems relatable.
Bro, how the fuck do I get out of here? I'm not using my blocks. Bro, I swear to God. I swear to God. You know what? I know what I'm doing.
What?
I'm gonna safe. I'm gonna play it safe. I know what I'm gonna do. This is smart. This is safe. Kill me, bitch. Kill me, bitch. Kill me, bitch. I'll get to sleep in a bed, and then you'll be dead. Bitch. I'll come back in my fucking second form. Oh, shit. Get in a fucking bed. Get in a bed.
Okay, damn.
You know what? I'd say I like that too, to be honest. I really would.
What?
All I could hear was... I was like, man.
Be right back.
Alright, back. I'll be right here. Man, I should take the fishing rod with me. Beetroot, yo. Hashtag my cabbages. Gotta get my stuff. Gotta get my bitch. I can smell the hoe on you. You know what? I'm turning off the Minecraft music for now. Back to the For Honor music. Oh, fuck. Thousands? Oh, shit, that's loud.
from wind on my face. Got a taser and now I just go for thrills. Find a baby, put a shot in his kill. Not mad, I'm the gadfly, no sign. I guess the world just gotta keep killing me still. Swimming like Socrates, no one's ever gonna be able to say things right. Acting like you're not there, but I still care, still share. With a blank face, wondering what the fuck is on the TV. With the VB, tell me take it someplace. Cause you really wanna please me, cause the blood is on my peaky.
I've been here too many times.
Max Kibo, yeah. I'ma save you the heartache, but it's time that we part ways. I'm not here for the long way, then my time is a short stay. You don't wanna have me, it's sad to see that everybody laugh at me. Like sad to see, now we just throw it back for me. So casually, like me, the deep, another cold one, swallowing out a whole one. Checking my pulse, I'm a dead, can't tell. All that I know is I'm leaving my soul as you're in my ears. Screaming, burn in hell, clip that. Cause one day, bitch, I'ma come back with the shit in your face. And your words and the scratch, somewhere in my eyes. Only care.
I have this idea that I want to try. My bad.
Back.
Hey, welcome back. You smell like a PK. Broski. Okay.
Huh?
Let me think. I think I wanted to go out a little bit farther.
There's so many more.
Bro, there's a new fucking Venom movie coming out. It's crazy.
Another one?
I think so.
That'd be what? Three? Four?
Three?
Because the last one...
Dude, I haven't even watched two yet. I'm so upset about that, actually.
I tried to, but when I did, I was too fucking tired, and I passed out, like, halfway through.
You bastard. How dare you?
Dude, I couldn't fucking help it. Like I said, I was just that tired.
Damn, okay.
I was sleepy.
I'm gonna make this area over here aesthetically pleasing.
I'm trying to figure out where the hell I put all my shit. Whatever, I got. I know where I put it. Whatever, it can all stay up there for now, I guess.
She might like that.
I like that I found gold before I found diamond.
Real, bro.
Like, I get that I am far enough below ground to find gold, but that doesn't mean I want to. I need iron, like... Give me iron, not gold. Gold is practically fucking useless to me right now.
Damn. Bro, that's crazy. Wait, no, that still stays right there.
Oh shit, it's nighttime. Yeah, fuck all that. I don't want to go outside.
Is that bitch I smell on you? Damn! Nothing? Nothing? You're gonna give me nothing for that? Really?
Go to bed,
really?
Bitch.
Fucking hoe? Get the fucking bed.
Hey. Hey.
Hey.
Eat the dick.
You smell like dick.
I have one.
Well, you know, that could be why then. Man. Man. Man.
Alright, I've got to find an actual cave, because mining out of my house is not cutting it.
Okay.
What, you laughing at what I said?
No, I'm laughing at what I was doing. I was fucking head bobbing in the game and real life, bro.
Oh. That's legit, I do that shit all the time.
Bro, I don't know.
Shit, I'll be sitting here head bobbing it and fucking my girlfriend look over at me, be like, what? Give me a look like, what the fuck? And then start doing it too.
Dude, that's a good girlfriend right there. That's pretty fucking awesome. Oh, man. I just fucking slapped cobblestone down in the wrong fucking spot. Hold on.
Dude, I thought I seen your gamer tag for a second there. Had to do a fucking double take.
Bro, that's crazy.
Like, that ass just... Deadass, I fucking forgot that I'm nowhere near you.
Nah, you're pretty close.
And did a double take.
I think you're pretty close. You're right outside. You're in my walls. How dare.
He's in the fucking walls!
He's in the
Pulls
fucking walls!
Pulls out AK.
Starts blasting the fucking walls.
Turns out, it's just a rat, and it now has a... All that's left of it is a foot because you shot a 50 BMG through the fucking wall. And through your neighbor's wall, and then it went. Like. You never hear, like, that fucking meme? 50 BMGs for, like, when you want to hit the bad guy through your neighbor's house.
Yeah.
Like, through their exterior wall and into their... And the refrigerator.
And the refrigerator is where it's at, bro. That was funny.
Like, 50 BMG is for when you want to hit the guy on the other side of your fucking neighbor's refrigerator. That's what that is. But if that's the case, then what's the 20mm for? Because that's bigger.
That's for when you want to launch the refrigerator at them with the bullet.
That's when you want to evaporate the fridge.
Next. Mia?
Nah, this is too much work just to find a cave. I've scaled a fucking mountain just to find a cave. And still haven't found a cave.
You're a cave.
You're a cave.
Bitch, I'm not a cave.
This seems like an argument with Tally in South Park. You're a towel.
No, you're a towel.
No, you're a towel.
Man.
Whatever happened to Tally? He just, like, stopped showing up.
Bro, I don't know. It's been a while since I've watched South Park. It sucks, too. I won't really like it. I think it's hilarious.
Howley was... He was a good character, but at the same time, it's like... Bro, you're offering drugs to children. Fucking stop.
Stop, bro. Yeah, for real.
Like, I genuinely did like Howley. It's just like... Howley was just fucked.
Tally is just fucked.
Like, having a
fucking
completely
tally.
Normal conversation, and then it just goes through, you wanna smoke some crack?
You wanna smoke some crack? Yeah, that.
Or was it crack or was it pot?
Yes.
Okay, fair. I found a cave. Fucking finally. I died in
was
that cave.
Slain.
Fuck.
By... Zombie, god
damn. It was one of the midget ones, though.
You're a midget one.
Eat a dick, you're a midget.
Bitch! I'm not a midget.
Shut up, 6 feet is not tall.
How tall is not tall?
6 feet is not tall.
Bro, you're not tall in my opinion until you're like 7'2", then we're gonna have an issue. Even then,
that
I'm still gonna
legit.
Be like, man, I'll fucking throw you through a goddamn trash compactor.
That's also legit.
Dude, fuck people, man. I don't give a fuck. Bro did something that pissed me off. I'm not gonna sit there and be like, oh, damn, he kinda big. I don't wanna get my ass beat. I'm like, nah, I'm gonna take this ass whooping, but I'm gonna fuck him up in the process.
No, that's legit though. Like, how the fuck? You're worried about size when you got motherfuckers like John Cena out there lifting 400 pound men at like maybe 250?
Real.
I think, something like that. Like, he was one big motherfucker.
Yeah?
Like, he's lifting... During his career in WWE, he also lifted, like, some really big motherfuckers. Like, 400-pound plus motherfucker.
Bro, I've seen, like, a fucking dude built, like, a silverback gorilla pick up his son that was, like, fucking, like, a little bit bigger than him over his fucking head and, like, fucking flipped him into the yard, bro. It was crazy. It was like, there was a fucking party one night, right? My brother threw a fucking party. We were living at their place. And his son was in on it. And, like, bro was like, fucking, like, 18.
Something tells me
like
you
that.
Told me this story before, but I don't mind listening to it.
I mean,
again.
It's the cheeseburgers, bro. It's the cheeseburgers.
You were in it for the food?
No. No, okay, so my brother had fucking thrown a party, right? Mom was gone. I was like, what, 8, 7 years old, right? Anyways. So, I'm fucking... stuck under my brother's watch. Well, they throw a party. There's drinking. There's bitches. There's fucking alcohol everywhere. There's porn playing on the big screen in the living room. I'm like, hell yeah, brother.
Typical well, party.
Well, I think they fucking got a noise complaint or something, because at some point the fucking cops showed up. And then after the cops showed up, my brother's dad showed up. And I was busy cussing him the fuck out and throwing up Christmas ornaments at him. Bro, I was like, okay, so it was like... up over a garage, right? Like it was a little apartment built into the house. It was like a studio apartment, though. It was so fucking cool. The only problem was the kitchen, the living room, and the fucking bedroom are all the same room. But, bathroom was big. Anyways, fucking what was I gonna say? Yeah, so I'm, like, up... in a window that's above the garage, right? The Christmas tree's right there. And, like, I have the window wide the fuck open. I go, you leave him alone, Jeffrey, you fucking bitch! And he goes, shut up, you little shit, or I'll come up there and drag you down by your hair! I was like, fuck you! Threw a fucking cheeseburger at him. Just started reaching into the McDonald's bag. There was like 90-something burgers in there. I started throwing Christmas ornaments and cheeseburgers at him.
Bro, you pulled that Hocus Pocus and now there's pizza on your focus. You know the one I'm talking about?
Dude, I think.
Do I have to track that shit down and send it to you now?
Bro, I don't know.
Oh, hold on. I'm gonna track that shit down and fucking send it to you real quick.
I need a sign. I need a sign. I need a sign. I need a sign, bro. Sign. Where's the sign? Fine. Where'd all my sticks go? Oh, they're there.
Please tell me this is the right one.
No, it's not. Get fucked. Damn, I gotta find fucking tree.
It was. Dude, the fucking accent is what gets me. Like, it's so fucking stupid, but the accent makes it so much better.
Real.
Alright, I sent it to you.
I will have many, many guards. I shall become the most paranoid king in the lands.
Yo! Ooh.
Yeah? The fuck was that, bro?
I found a cave and now it's scary. I don't like
that! Oh, yeah.
I don't want your Girl Scout cookies, go the fuck away! You asshole! You booger looking bitch!
Fucking awesome.
Fucking creeper. You asshole, go away!
This fucking gooner, bro.
Why? Fucking go away, you assholes! Dick! Oh. Oh, you pigeon looking bitch. I don't think you'd be laughing so much if you seen the shit that I just had to witness.
You are a witness. Oh, wait. Alright, anyways.
I don't like witnesses, man.
Fuck man, you. I'm not a fan of witnesses. Pulls out the Glock.
When the Jehovah's Witness knocks on your door.
Bro, somebody just sent me a message for my For Honor shit. Like, the fucking clip.
Which clip?
You know how, like, did I show you, like, the numbers for the, like, the shorts that I put out for my screen being broken?
You said that they got quite a few views.
Well, Destiny, one of them's at like 206, another one's at 571, and then another one's at 510. It's been less than a day for the Destiny one, and about that long for the 206 one. The 510 one. Dude, somebody said most calm For Honor session. I'm like, wow, bro.
Alright, can you sleep so I can get back to my cave without
fuck
dying?
Fuck you.
No, fuck you.
No, fuck you.
Fuck you more.
Most calm For Honor sesh. In fucking quotations, bro. I love that. I want to use that for a fucking video. Whenever I accidentally do decide to take something out in a fit of rage, that'd be crazy. I think Demon should do it with me. We'll both buy new TVs.
Funny that you think I can afford that.
Wow! Okay. When I make it big, I'll buy you a new TV.
My TV actually isn't that bad, though.
Real. This one wasn't like, either, bro. It had HDR included. Now I gotta fucking buy a better one. You know, if I look at this the right way, as long as I get the TV, this is technically just an upgrade. It gives me an excuse to get a new one.
Dude, I lost all of my shit. I can't seem to find this fucking cave again.
Bro, you need to rememberize your shit.
You need to rememberize your shit.
You need to rememberize your shit.
You need to rememberize how to not throw your fucking coffee cup at your TV.
Bitch, I didn't throw it at the fucking TV. This motherfucker, dude. This motherfucker.
Fine, rememberize that your TV's unstable and don't put a metal fucking cup in front of it.
Okay, that's real.
And then proceed to knock the fucker down.
I didn't mean to, bro. Leave me alone. I did nothing wrong.
It's I think your fault. TV would say otherwise.
Oh, you bitch. This motherfucker, dude.
Accurate information.
Fucking accurate as fuck, bro.
Asshole.
Fucking dick lips. Okay. Bro.
Dude, insulting your friends is fucking amazing.
Isn't it? Every time Rose tries to do it to me, I'm like, damn, that hurt my feelers. I'm never gonna recover.
See, I'm kind of in a similar position. I play it off, but I won't normally cast an insult back when it comes to my girlfriend.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Like, I don't want to... I know I'm fucked if I'm going to cast an insult. She'll
Bro, you clap back, she will fucking...
She'll ground my ass.
She will, bro.
Like, I'll get stuck sleeping on the couch in my own fucking house.
Crazy how that works, isn't it?
Yeah. Like, the place that I live, I'd end up sleeping on the fucking couch if I clapped back at my girlfriend.
Damn, I need more of that fucking crystal shit. Now I gotta go underground.
I got more.
Fuck you.
You talking about the amethyst crystal?
Yeah.
Yeah, dude, I've got like a whole nother stack and a half, I think.
I only need a couple, bro. I need my crystal fix.
Bro's out here, I need my fix. About to fucking tweak out.
Bro, can I get a front on that? Starts fucking talking in code. It'd be crazy, bro.
Bro hits you with that.
Man! Fuck. I don't know what I'm doing, bro. I really don't. I'm trying to figure it out. Is it daytime or nighttime?
It was daytime when I entered the cave.
You know, before I last saw the sun.
The last time I went outside.
It was winter.
Of 1904.
Of 1904 is wild. Yeah. Bro, that's brazy.
Fuck you, midget.
That's even wilder. Damn, bro, these dogs are all gonna be fucking half retarded because they're inbred. Dude.
Out of context, your fucking chat is gonna, like, cook me.
Why?
Me just randomly yells, fuck you, midget.
Fuck you, midget. Yeah, that's if anybody makes it this far into the stream. It takes a while for people to, like, actually watch. Man.
I'm gonna... Once it uploads, though, I'm gonna send you the clip of what just happened. Because, like, every time I try to enter the main, like, cavern, there's something right fucking there.
You're a cavern. Get fucked.
Eat a
man. Oh, I see how it is. Okay. Gargle a bottle sack. Motherfucker.
Yeah. Easy there, taint tickler. Don't get yourself all worked up.
Listen here, Diddy Diddleheimer. I need you to calm the fuck down. Fucking taint tickler. Fuck off, bro.
You just mad because that was a good one.
It was good.
Just be happy I didn't call you the diddler.
I'm fucking...
Listen here.
Did he do it?
Listen here, alright. Don't get mad at me because you fucking diddled the Riddler to tickle the diddler.
I'm gonna fucking slap you with a fucking raw fish, bro. I'm gonna slap you so fucking hard with this rubber fish that you're gonna be like, fuck my neck like a rubber chicken. I'm gonna look at you like, what?
What the fuck?
Bro, you wanna hear how I heard that? You wanna hear how I heard that? Like, recently?
How?
It's so fucking funny, bro. So, we were trying to get through, fucking traffic, right? It was like, there was a fucking parade going through town. We cut across a fucking, like, what is it? It's like a... It's not a turn lane, like a crossing lane. You know, like, when the fucking yellow lines are, like, it's yellow on the outside... Like, solid on the outside, and then dotted on the inside, and then across from it, yeah. There's another one, but it's, like, all just one lane, right? So we had, like, swerved into traffic in front of that, right? Like, into that shit, right? There was a parade in town. People were fucking, like, trying to pick up their kids and shit. Bro fucking, like, swerves out into that fucking shit. Well, not swerves out. That's a little too high key there. Fucking, like, tries to turn out into it and shit. Fucking somebody was trying to keep coming. And he was like, fuck my neck like a rubber chicken. I look at him and I go, what'd you just say? He goes, fuck, you've never heard that? Fuck my neck like a rubber chicken. I'm like, he's like, you know those ones that, like, you squeeze and they go, I'm like, yeah, that's what I thought. Is it crazy that I, like, imagined a rubber chicken, but it's a fleshlight?
Oh my god.
Oh, fuck, there goes that torch. Great. Fucking creepers, dude. Hate them. Hate them, bro.
Dude, our conversations... You know you got a good friend when your conversations are this random.
Real. Bro. You never know what's gonna happen next.
No, because it, like...
Skeleton? More skeleton?
Dude, that fucking... I was in the process of trying to figure out what the fuck I was trying to say, and then I just heard...
My dog did it first, bro. I had to do it back.
That's what that was?
Yeah, he goes, oh, and I'm like, ah.
Dude, I thought that was a fucking shitty ass rubber chicken. Like, I genuinely thought you gave, like, the quickest, like, lightest fucking squeeze to a rubber chicken.
dude. I would fucking die if I was on that end of the conversation, dude. I would lose it. I wouldn't even be able to fucking, like, breathe.
I we did lose it. Would have to give
me an oxygen mask and be like, bro, chill.
Bro, I was already in the process of fucking losing it. And then I get hit with... from your fucking dog. That I always forget exists.
Bro, that dog is wild, isn't he?
So, hold on. Did you actually name your dog Dingus? Or do you
his
just
name
call it that?
Is Dingus Conrad, but he has a middle name, and it's only for when I'm pissed off.
Okay, so you actually did name your dog Dingus, then.
His name is Dingus Khan. You get it right, sir.
Okay.
You get it right. Only his family can call him Dingus. That's
okay,
not true.
Yeah.
Dingus Khan is my reserve name for him. Everybody else fucking leaves him be. We call
no,
him Dingus,
like
Digoose, Digamoose, Dignobi, General Dignobi, Digitardo. Bro, there's a lot of names for him, bro.
That's fucking great.
I know, right?
General Dignobi.
General Dignobi. What say you?
Dude, to hear it. To hear that in just General Grievous's voice. General Dignobi.
General Dignobi. Bro, if I had a voice changer, I'd totally do it. I would. If I could do the impression at all, I would. I would love that. General Dignobi. Alright, we're back.
Alright, I gotta find this fucking cave again.
I found more iron, bro. Swimming in it.
So did I, and that's why I have to find the cave again.
Man, fuck, you made me make that trip for no reason, bro.
No, when you made that trip, I hadn't found iron yet.
Well,
like,
fuck
I hadn't
you.
Even, I didn't
no
even know that
reason.
A cave existed yet. I was trying to mine iron from my house.
Crazy. I was crazy once. They put me in a room. A rubber room. Rubber room with rats. Do you know that rats make me crazy, bro? The fuck is this?
POV your dog.
POV your dog.
What kind of dog is it? Just out of curiosity.
Bro, he's like a lab, maybe part pit.
Really?
Bro,
based on the
pretty.
Sound that it made, I thought it was a pug.
Dingus.
Being dead ass.
Bro, I will show you a picture if you want to see him.
I'm down. I like dogs. I just genuinely thought, based on the fucking sound that I heard that dog make a little bit ago, I genuinely thought that fucker was a pug. Because that pugs are the only dog breed that I ever
Dingus.
Hear make sounds like that.
Good boy. Bro, he actually, like, paused for the camera. That's crazy. I don't take pictures of you, bro. Is that mom? Is that mom doing that? It's mom doing that. Hey, watch out. You're gonna knock my cup over. It's got a lid on it, but
don't,
still.
Don't throw the cup.
Not again.
Your dog's actually the one that broke the TV.
Bro, that'd be wild, wouldn't it?
Your dog just grabs
POV,
the coffee cup
dog.
And throws it.
POV your dog.
I've never seen your dog, but I already love him.
Bro, he's
fuck.
Amazing. Oh, shit. I'm gonna be real with you, Chief. I don't remember how to get out of here.
That's real.
Hit him with the O, okay.
Oh, shit.
Bro, looks kind of like the werewolf from Harry Potter.
Oh. That's a beautiful dog.
I know, right? Dude, he can fuck shit up, too. I've seen it. I had to, so, like, when he was growing up, right, I fucking, like, taught him how to, like, fight other dogs and shit. Like, I didn't make him fight other dogs, okay? But, like, I would play with him and shit and, like, show him where he's weak at, pretty much. Like, where he's easy to grab and how he's easy to grab. And he figured out over time.
Hey, I have to guard these spots, otherwise I'm gonna get fucked up.
Yeah, so, like, whenever, like, 4 years ago, right? Like, this happened a few, a lot, actually. Like, more than a few. There's, like, three dogs that would run around the area. In the place I lived, like, they were the other people's dogs, but, like, they're fucking kind of assholes. Like, they would, like, when he was still, like, new and shit, like, real new, they would, like, fight over food and shit, and, like, three of them would jump on him, and he fucked all of them up, bro. He had fucking, like, biggest one fucking pinned to the ground and shit.
That's amazing.
Bro, he's wild. No.
Sounds like it. Holy shit. That drown's gonna... Oh, fuck! That one's got a trident! Oh, you ass.
I gotta get the fucky out of here, bro.
That was me trying to escape the drown that impaled me.
Yeah, that's me right now. Oh, fuck.
I love dogs, but... In all honesty, even if I get to a place where I can have one...
A cat's easier to take care of. A cat's easier. You can ignore those motherfuckers. They'll be chilling.
I'm not a big cat person, though.
No, are you?
Just because
you're not an animal person at all, bro.
No, I like dogs.
Get a fish.
No, I'd be too tempted to eat it.
Bro, nah. No, well, you get, like, a cool enough fish, bro. Chilling.
Here's the thing, though, Reaper. I grew up fishing.
I did too, motherfucker.
Well, I didn't know that, but, like...
Wow.
We'd catch bullhead catfish, and...
Yummy.
That was fucking dinner.
Yummy.
And I don't want no goldfish.
What kind of
fish
do you
want? The kind that ends up in my stomach.
Damn, bro, get like some fucking, like, okay, what you do, you start a breeding tank of tuna, right?
Can you even legally own a tuna?
Yes.
Because I know there's probably some that you can't.
I think you have to have permits, but...
Probably.
Here's what you do.
That's probably considered like some sort of exotic pet.
Start yourself a breeding camp of catfish. Just leave them in there for long enough that they just breed and breed and breed, right? And then they're just a bunch of delicious, retarded fish swimming around everywhere.
Delicious retards.
Delicious retards, bro. I'm telling you, you know why? I know it's fucked up, but they're also too stupid to swim away from you. And when they try to race off, they'll fucking just start flipping sideways.
That's accurate information.
It's also fucked up, dude. Who's the people that, like, gets really pit, like, a PETA, bro, PETA. PETA's gonna fucking riot.
They're gonna raid your fucking stream.
They're gonna raid my fucking house, bro, with tear gas and shotguns.
They're all for animal rights. Human rights, not so much.
Bro, Mans makes joke about retarded fish breeding camp, gets raided and shot and executed out in the street with
his
family the next day.
PETA.
On live television. Breaking news today in our country.
PETA executed some motherfucker.
He is now the world's biggest streamer in the world. bro. That'd be wild. You know how pissed off I'd be? You know how pissed off I'd be if my ship blew up in popularity, but I'm already dead?
If your ship blew up because you got executed by PETA?
Real. Now, if I, like, barely survive the execution, and then I come back, make a full recovery, I'm down. I am so down. What?
I'd still support.
I'd still make the retarded breeding camp. What are you talking about?
I still support.
The retarded fish breeding camp, bro. That's where it's at. I need some cats.
Well, here's my stance on it, though. If you can't... You can be for animal rights. Like, don't get me wrong.
Uh-huh.
Don't, like... If you're beating the shit out of an animal for no reason...
That's kind of fucked.
That's wrong. But hunting and fishing, as long as it's not overdone, is a good thing.
That's true, bro. There's certain animals we have to fucking, like, over... Like, to hunt the shit out of because they will fuck everything up. They're an invasive
species more than
that
a...
we put there.
Yeah. That it goes for every animal, though. Like, if there's too many of them, it's gonna fuck everything up.
Bro, there's a crab that's... Like, I talked about this the other day, bro. The, remember when I was telling
yeah,
you about
you told
the crab?
Yeah, you told me about this. Yeah.
Yeah, there's a species of crab that breeds so fucking fast and, like, fucking, like, eats so many different kinds of fucking life, bro, that, like, it's going into areas, right, that are, like, really fucking fragile ecosystems, and they just kill everything that's there, and then just spread across the seafloor. Like, it's fucking recommended on a fucking huge scale to fucking kill those crabs. It doesn't matter if you're gonna eat them or not, kill that fucking crab is pretty much the motto.
Fuck that crab.
Hashtag fuck that crab.
Hashtag Mr. Crab needs to die.
I second that motion. Alright, anyways.
Just hashtag kill Eugene.
Kill Eugene. Damn, okay.
Eugene Crabs.
Eugene. Mr. Crabs. I need stone.
Mr. Crabs.
Okay. Mr. Crabs.
Thor Bonger.
Shut up. Okay, anyways. Bro, out here with the door bongers.
I'm gonna Should go by a... that now. That is my warmonger. My warmonger from now on will be called door bonger.
Bordonger.
Bordonger. Come on, door man. It's not that bro. Big.
Okay. Here we go.
We're you set me up way. For that joke.
I really did, and I didn't mean to. I regret it already. Alright. So.
Yes. The good old dick joke.
Yes, a good old dick.
I want to show you this cave real quick. So I'm gonna...
Yeah.
Video. Hide HUD.
Smell like Ligma, bro. Damn! Fuck.
Oh shit, that probably just showed my HUD.
I'm not gonna look.
I haven't sent it.
Damn, bro. How the fuck do I make that? No. 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 No, 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 no. Yeah, yes! That's what I need. I need to see what those are. So, that's... planks. Okay. Okay, so that's 1, 2, 3.
I'm glad nothing attacked me because I can't see my fucking HUD, so I don't know when to stop pressing the button.
Bro, I gotta go until something shows up. Fucking nether. Oh, I know. I just gotta find slimes. You got any slime, bro? You got some slime?
Actually, I do have a little bit.
No way.
Yeah, dude, there were slimes in this cave. I've got like 24 slime balls.
What do you want for those slimes?
What do you have?
Do you want to... I don't know. What do you need?
I don't know.
Well, you need a saddle?
No. What? No, I don't have any use for a horse.
Okay, you want... I can offer you a bow.
If you have some arrows, I'll take that.
I do have arrows. I have 9 arrows, bro. Big chillin'.
Because I've got a bow.
Man. What do you need right now to make arrows?
Feathers and flint, I'm pretty sure, is what it takes.
I mean, well, it's a stick too, bro.
Well, yeah, but I've got a lot of fucking planks. I can make the sticks.
Bro's like, I got the sticks. I am the sticks. Behold my sticks.
Behold my balls.
Behold these nuts. Man, bro.
Oh, God, I gotta get back on this when I get out of work.
I have 9 arrows, 13 flint, and 32 sticks.
Alright, I'll bring the slime balls to you.
Here, I'll bring you some iron, too. How much you want? Oh, wait, you're fucking rich in iron now. Never mind. Fuck. Mr. Iron Man over here. Oh. Is it daytime or nighttime?
Fuck, I don't know, man. I live in a hole in the ground.
Can only sleep at night. And yet I hear Endermen and zombies outside of my house. Crazy.
I have to hear the same shit half the time, so it's okay. I still genuinely think that you would be fucking proud of me if you seen my house.
I kind of want to see your house, but at the same time, if I see your house, I cannot make any promises.
I mean... if Rose isn't gonna get back on, we can always team. Because I don't know if Zaya will.
If anything, I can just tell her, like, if she just has trouble getting here, I'll literally just go back to spawn and walk her here.
Alright, so I forgot to put my weapons away.
I forgot to put my balls away? Oh.
So what I'm gonna do is I'm going to make some planks on the go, and I'm gonna make a chest. And then what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna put my weapons and shit in the chest. So that, you know, there can be some trust had.
I...
600 negative 600 again, right?
Almost no health, so I'm sorry about this, but I'm taking my weapons with me. But I can't actually make it. I can make a chest. I can't. No, I cannot.
I will.
It's about to be nighttime, bro.
Alright, so we'll just chill in the hole after we get there, I guess. I don't know.
The fuck? Where am I going? Oh.
I'm asking myself the same question. Just so you know, if you haven't left your house yet, I already did, so I'm not... I don't have a bed with me.
Bro, I'm already, here.
Wait, did you want more of those amethyst crystals?
I mean...
Fuck, I'll go back to my house, hang on.
Man, fuck you, I don't have a bed, bro. I'm digging a hole. I'm leaving a torch right here. Actually, even better. Even fucking better.
Alright, you don't have a bed? I guess we'll just follow through with this trade and we'll get you the amethyst crystal some other time.
That's fine. I mean, I'm chilling, bro. I'm chilling. I'm just on top of a tree.
I'm working my way over to 600, 600. Or 600, negative 600.
Yeah, that part. Damn, that's pretty dope. Okay.
Got a bunch of fucking zombies chasing me and only 3 hearts.
You're
oh,
a
shit.
You're a zombie.
You're a zombie.
You're a zombie.
You're a towel.
You're a towel.
Why is that fucking impression so good? Fuck. Towel you are.
Towel you are.
Fucking impressions, man.
They're not that great, bro. They're not that great.
Better than mine.
Chill, bro.
They're better than mine.
Me checking the blinds every time I hear a car door shut like a crackhead because I'm trying to see if mom's home. It's a fucking witch. Lovely. Sure do love that.
Oh yeah, always. So are you there already?
I'm in a tree.
Fuck!
Yeah? Oh, fuck! Nope. What the fuck? Bitch! Okay.
Alright.
Hey, let's sleep.
I'll get you more. Yeah, I'll get you more slime balls.
Damn, broski, damn.
Because in all honesty, I don't think I'll be able to find my way back.
You sure? It should be on the way, right?
Oh, no, I guess I'll make more tools and we'll find out.
Okay. Damn, bro. I am sorry.
Nah, you're good.
Man...
Think about it like this.
My ass back over there.
I'm back at my base. I'll bring you the rest of my amethyst.
You're not gonna use them for anything?
Which is a stack of 46. Nah.
Okay. I don't know what that was, bro. Don't ask. I went fucking...
Think about it like this, though. I might just... There's a possibility that I can just find another amethyst... thing.
You're an amethyst thing. Bitch. Yeah? You were saying?
Hello? So, like, I can always just get more. Because there's bound to be one somewhere.
True.
Or if you get some in the future, I can always trade you for it.
Future. Oh, fuck.
Future.
Squidward, who's your favorite rapper?
Future.
Fuck. Alright, there we go. Found all my shit. Lost
I still like how very, even after all these years, very few people fuck with Eminem.
No, they tried to.
It doesn't work, though. The ones that, like, they're, if you think about it, though, there's really not many that do. And all the ones that are still rapping from his time refuse to. Except for Snoop, I think, was a more recent one.
Yeah.
Wasn't it, or was that a few years ago?
It was like a few years ago.
But, like, everybody else from that time, just like, nah. we don't want none. We know what happened to MGK, man.
Nah, bro, they know what happened to Ja Rule.
Him too, actually, yeah.
They also know what happened to cannabis.
That one I didn't know about, but...
You didn't know about that one? Dude.
No, I know about Ja Rule, so funny. MGK. I like to Benzino. Make fun of the MGK one. Oh yeah, that's another one. Fuck, he ruined that guy's career.
Dude, that guy's career fucking stopped existing.
Like, I keep seeing clips lately of, like, this guy's career is fucking... so fucked now that all he ever gets asked about in interviews is Eminem.
Bro was crying in the interview, right?
Yeah. Like, his career is so beyond dead now because of that.
That's what he gets, bro. You start some shit. Start some shit. There's always
don't
something
start
to fucking
shit
pay,
with the
bro.
White boy. Like... I'm sorry, but... My logic behind this is, like, rap music is a predominantly, like, they are, that, it's mostly black rappers.
Uh-huh.
He's a white boy in a...
No. There's a lot of white rappers now, too. It's just not many of them hit those top tier areas.
Yeah, true. That's now, though. He was successful before that.
Mm-hmm. I mean, there was, like, you... Vanilla Eyes. I think maybe MC but even... Hammer was white.
No, MC Hammer wasn't.
Oh, no, he just got fucked then.
MC Hammer, I'm pretty sure, was not white.
Oh. I don't know. I don't look up pictures of these people.
Vanilla Ice was, but his career was ruined.
The same way?
Was that by Eminem, or... It was either...
I don't know, but Eminem sure as fuck keeps talking shit about him, and it's hilarious.
Dude. They need to follow one simple rule. Don't fuck with the white boy.
Don't fuck with the white boy. It was a...
Alright, so I didn't find my fucking shit.
Mm-hmm.
So, here's this, and this, and I'll get you more slime balls at some point. I fell.
Damn, okay, here. Take that. What else was I gonna do?
If I find my shit on the way back, I'll make my way back here at some point.
Take one of these.
But... Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Fuck.
Like, it's actually, It's a simple rule. Don't fuck with the white boy and your career won't end.
This is why everyone thinks we're racist, bro.
I mean, yes, but it's like, with Eminem, it's actually, like, a valid rule.
Nah, bro, he's even fucking snapped back. He's like, hey, because I'm fucking white?
He's the blackest white guy you'll ever meet, but that's not the point.
You're the whitest black guy I've ever met. What's your point?
No, I actually am white.
I know. That's the point.
But it's, I don't know, man. It's just, don't, he might be the blackest white boy you'll ever meet, but don't fuck with him.
Yeah. I want something to eat, bro. I want something to eat. I don't know what I'm going to eat, but I'm going to eat something. Yes.
I found coal.
You found coal in your coal hole?
No. I found coal in some random ass coal hole.
That's crazy, bro. Do you hate it when you get coal from your coal hole? Nothing more. Bro, where the fuck? Where? Can't see shit.
Why the fuck? You ever consider that one? Why the fuck?
How the fuck? Did you know?
Who the fuck?
When the fuck? Oh, what the fuck?
How the fuck? I think we've covered all the fucks now.
Man, I don't fucking know.
This bit was so fucking stupid.
Dude, it wasn't even a bit, bro. It just happened.
It happened, but I turned it into a bit.
Bro, you made it a bit. This is why, man, somebody's gonna walk and be like, bro, his videos are scripted. I'm gonna be like, fuck you, bro. How do I script this?
There's no fucking way you're scripting this. I'm just choosing. Like, I'm making a conscious decision to make a bit out of dumb shit.
There's no fucking way that I could script this, dude. That'd be fucking wild. How brain damaged would I have to be?
You have some wild people writing your scripts then, dude. Fuck.
Dude, you know how much meth I had to stay up the other day to fucking write this script?
Damn near OD, man.
Fuck. Damn near OD'd. But you know what? I finished the script in the hospital. And here we are.
I finished it, tweaked out of my mind, in the fucking hospital.
And now you can tell for sure. Alright, anyways.
Nah, there's no way any of this shit is scripted. Like, nah. There really isn't. If you're saying that this shit is scripted, you must be fucking retarded. And I'm talking like, that shit is chronic brain damage. Like, you cannot recover.
I remember when I had chronic brain damage. I got it from chronic masturbation.
Dude, that character was so fucking funny in that game, though. No, The Walking Dead, remember? You guys want to know how I got put in here?
Oh, fuck.
You forgot about him, didn't you?
Yeah.
What the fuck was its name? Can't remember.
Mitch? No, he dead. Never mind.
No, yeah, Mitch was the bomb guy, wasn't he?
Yep, he's dead.
He was... After you started to get along with him, he was likable.
Yeah, likable. Yeah, but he was an asshole.
He was.
I'm not gonna lie, this is the first, this time, I did not intentionally get him killed, but he totally died.
It wasn't intentional. Everyone else, it just happened.
It was crazy. He dies, right? Somebody in the game's like, no! And I'm just sitting there like, oh, no, man. Damn, that sucks.
Oh,
man, how are we going to recover, bro? Damn, that's wild.
I feel so bad for him.
Man, fucking, I'm gonna, next time I see the person who killed him, I'm gonna kill them. And a stone, I mean, kill them with a bullet.
I'm gonna give him a high five and a blunt, I mean. Fuck!
Bro, like, dude, I low-key...
Can you sleep so I can go get my shit?
Yeah, can you find some slimes for me? That would be awesome.
I will after I go get my shit, because I never made it back to my base.
Bro, I should have built on spawn. Fuck you. I should have just built on spawn. Now that I think about it. You know why? Because nobody's ever going to find my base. I did too good. Now I'm going to have to make a forward operation center. And put it right in your front yard. I'm joking, by the way. I'm joking.
I know.
It's okay.
I know.
It's okay. Don't worry. You don't need to be afraid.
There was a skeleton right above my fucking house.
Real.
Bro had me going.
Run. Raggy. I'm creating an army. You know what I'm gonna do? You know what I'm thinking of doing?
What?
I'm thinking of making another portal, right? Having the other end, making sure the other end is connected to a room in the nether, right?
Yo, I think I lost all of my fucking iron.
That's like in like one of those fucking, you probably did. One of those, them homosexuals. No, anyways. What was I saying? Oh, yeah, I want a fucking nether portal into my building, right? Mm-hmm. But, like, on, like, an outer fucking, like, area of it. Oh, fuck. This asshole. Dude, what the fuck? What the dog doing, bro? Motherfucker. Alright, this is just my life now, I guess.
I am not.
A motherfucker I may be, but a mother, I'm fucking ain't no mother to me.
Fucking damn it.
What?
I don't think I've ever fucking heard that. That was great.
I'm not even the one that made that, bro.
I know you're not, but I don't think I've ever fucking heard that. Oh, shit.
Damn, bro. I have an army.
Is that my shit I see, or is that a bunch of flowers? I can't fucking tell from...
It's both now.
My shit got turned into flowers.
Bro cries.
I fucking would.
I would too. God damn, bro.
I think it's just flowers.
The absurd amount of disappointment this man would feel. Block of Ligmathist.
Okay. Come on, man. I just want to find my shit before I have to go to work.
I just want to shit my find before I work on my shit. You know? You know what I mean? Huh?
Oh, I found my shit. I think. Is this one way? That's a pickaxe. It's definitely. Oh, I found my shit. Okay. Thank fucking Christ, dude.
You shit your found?
I shit in your found.
I found in your shit.
I shit in the lost
this condom.
Found.
Oh.
Yeah, no, there's no fucking way this shit's scripted.
Okay.
Dude, it's not possible.
It's not possible, bro.
Nah, where's the rest of my shit, though?
Bro, who the fuck is, like, slamming their car horn outside? All I heard was... I'm like, bro, chill.
Dude, I just want to know where the rest of my shit is. Like, I found...
I found
my tools. 23 melons. Like, this is iron tools.
Yeah.
I want to know where the rest of my shit is.
It's there, bro. It just is. Damn, I'm about to waste my one fucking diamond like a boss. This is, of course, the way of living. This is the only way to live, is by wasting all your good shit on the most dumb shit you can. What am I missing? Two pieces of wood?
Oh, wait!
Oh, fuck off!
Reaper!
What?
This is the... I found the slime boss.
Yes, bro.
That's what this death was.
Crazy how it sat there that long.
I know. If only I could find the rest of my shit, like my fucking iron.
That would be crazy, wouldn't it? Should I make a jukebox? I'm gonna make a jukebox. I made a jukebox. Now everyone dies.
I wonder, is it just further down this way? Like, did I somehow fucking...
Behold my death metal tunes, says no one ever. Except for... Yeet. Yup. These beats are banging. Hell yeah.
So I'm basically at the trade spot.
Oh, do I need to come over there? Yeah, my bad.
No, I mean, might as well. I got the slime shit on me.
I got the shit slime? Hell yeah.
I'm playing Slime Rancher. I got the shit slime.
I shit
new
it out
slime.
New slime
discovered.
Slimy shit.
It's just a fucking log.
Like a literal log of shit.
There's nothing special about it. It can only move when the wind blows.
It's just there. When the wind blows is wild.
It just sits there and stinks. If you don't have the solar shield, it dries out.
Okay. Fair enough, I suppose.
It only eats corn.
You only eat corn. Wrecked nerd. You're a corn consumer. And I have no more fucking iron, god damn it. Alright, anyways. Just gonna make a fuckload of torches real quick before I come over there, okay? Okay, cool.
That's okay, because I went the wrong way, now I have to find my way back.
I feel that. The fuck? That sheep scared me, bro. Turns game into an adventure world so you can no longer mine. Damn, that'd be crazy.
Gives you no more privileges than what a visitor would get.
You can walk, damn, bro, that's it.
I've been demoted.
I've been demoted to subhuman. I am now an NPC. You know what I'm gonna do?
What?
I have an idea.
Shit, it's turning night.
I know. Fuck sitting in a hole. I got this, Chief. This is gonna be a trading outpost.
Okay. Here's your slime.
Okay. Thank you.
I'm gonna dig a hole real quick.
Take some torches real quick. Do you have torches? Do you need torches?
I have 25.
I'll throw you into the nether. There you go.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. You're so lucky it's not day 60, or I swear to God, I would kill you in such a friendly way.
I'd accept my fate.
As the homies do, of course. Death by schnoot. Okay. Where?
As Jeb would say, scratch and sniff.
Sniff and scratch. Snatch and scriff.
Do you need some more cobblestone?
I mean, I'll take it.
Because I'm down here mining it.
I wish I had a flint and steel so I could light this fucking tree on fire.
Well, I don't have any flint, but
I guess I'll just use this right now.
Oh shit, I can't get out of here now. Hold up.
Brazy.
No, because I'm a fucking retard.
Fucking.
And
yeah. Ow, you fucking stupid ass bitch ass fucking zombie. Fuck you. Go away. Be gone, ho. Ow.
Be gone, fuck. You need some help out here?
No, I'd never need help. Me? Need help? Nah. Maybe. Emotional support would be nice.
Well, here's some cobblestone.
Fuck, close enough. Why did I do that? Fuck, hold on.
Fuck you, you spider bitch. Spider bitch.
Man, this spider be bitching. Yes, sir. Sigma the Sloth.
Fucking hell.
It's so stupid, isn't it?
I hate it.
I want to see the fan art.
I don't.
I do.
I don't.
I don't wanna.
Bro, Rose is so funny when she reminds me to eat, bro. She goes, food, suck it. And that's like only thing I saw when I went to fucking look at fucking Discord was the words suck it, bro. I was like, what? That's like, damn, bro. Why you gotta do me like that? Okay, so real quick, pick this. Not real quick about this. No. That's a little annoying to get in. There we go. Yeah, it'll be fine. Yeet.
Yoink.
Sploink. So I do have slimes? Yes! Slimy slimes. Give me my slimes. You know what'd be awesome?
What?
If I knew what to build the roof out of. So instead, I'm gonna do it out of these. Wait, hold on, wait. That first? Yes! Here. Chow. You don't have any deep slate on you, do you?
No, as it happens, I don't.
Damn! Why do you hate me?
I'll go mine some if I can ever get the fuck out of here.
Bro, I need two pieces of-
What the fuck?!
I'm just gonna stand up here and
you know, not- Yeah, you can just there. Have my shit. Fuck that.
I'm not touching your shit. You can keep that. I don't want that.
Oh, I have more iron. Nah, you're good. You can take it. Fuck it.
Nah. Wait, is that food?
I'm not- Dude, I'm not coming back for it right now. I gotta go to work soon. Just take it.
Fine. God damn, you leave me to sort through all your fucking shit in your inventory? Jesus Christ, dude. How much stuff do you have?
I have more at my base.
Just the randomest shit for no reason other than because it's funny. Damn.
Oh shit, I'm gonna have to go get more planks soon.
Plankton?
Plankton? Plankton.
A copper ingot. It's a spider.
Alright, I'm gonna start making armor now. Damn, if I had one more ingot.
Real, bro.
I should have held off on the shield. Oh well, whatever.
Nah, the shield's more useful. Fuck the helmet.
No, I'm missing the boots.
Bro, why did you start with the helmet? You always...
Prevent them headshots.
You always drip out from the feet up, bro. Everyone knows this.
Well, I'm retarded, so I need the helmet. Keeps me from licking my bedroom windows. Fuck.
That's insane.
Insane or accurate?
Accurate, if you will.
Alright, fine. Insane or accurate?
Accurate, if you will.
Accurate, whatever. Insane or accurate?
Accurate, if you will.
Fuck off. Dick.
Ho.
Yeah. Oh,
I'm not used to 2:30. Hold on. Let me get back in my house and then I'll come out.
Are you late? Goodbye, demon. Goodbye. He is gone, and I'm trying to figure out shit in Minecraft! They already got me in here, playing Minecraft. Now I'm playing Minecraft all alone. Fuck! It's gonna be a great time to figure this shit out, huh? Well, nobody's around. Okay, so there's the redstone. I need iron! Fuck, bro. Where'd my iron go? I'll just go get... Man, bro, that's crazy. Damn. All right. I guess while I'm bored as hell, I can listen to something. I'll be back. I'm gonna fucking eat something. After I make the studio. Fuck that. I'll fucking figure it out later. Unless, did I really? I did. Oh, god damn. I'll finish my thing and then I'll go eat. If I don't, Rose will bust in my fucking door like the Kool-Aid man. Don't bro, any iron up here? Looks like a solid no, Jeeve. Damn, bro, that's crazy. Crazy? Oh, that's crazy once. Put me in a room. A rubber room. A room with rats. Rats make me crazy. Crazy? Oh, that's crazy once. Put me in a room. A rubber room. A rubber room with rats. Bitch. You're a bitch, bro. How you gonna fucking, like, try to fucking sidestep me like that? Fucking push me off. This ain't For Honor. Go away. Oh, fuck you. Bitch. Fucking fine, I'll go underground. But more. Fucking what? Dude, I can't remember where it's at. It's bothering me. Hug the left wall. Idiot. Alright. No, not there. Gotta be that way. It's not that one. It's gotta be this way, right? There's no fucking shot. I'm just this brain dead. It's this way. Say drip to the feet. Reet, reet. I'll be right back. Real.
Fixing your hair is not going to improve your photo. You are stuck with the face that you have. Do yourself a favor next time, girl. Leave this hideous boyfriend at home. It will save you the embarrassment of having to walk next to him.
Damn, that's crazy. I loved your movie.
I want to be part of your world. Oh, great. You look like you just did on a workout video for losers. Do you want to do CrossFit or something? You look like CrossFitters. Yeah, especially the one in the middle with the yoga pants. Why is the one at the end of a man bag and a backpack? Why do you need so many things to carry your things around? Yes. Who's next?
Crazy.
Or stand in my presence if you dare.
Like that,
but what are you doing? What's this male doing? Getting a close-up of my chin? Well, well.
Coding. But why code?
You're the one who intentionally buys shirts that are too small. I bet you could do 20 diamond push-ups right now. Right now, 20. Diamond push-ups, let's hear.
2. Well, not my own videos, that's for damn sure. That'd be crazy.
Earn up to $130 for your first 2 plasma donations with flexible hours.
Oh, really?
Picture this. You're sitting at home alone watching YouTube videos, wondering why you can't find the motivation to do the things you need or want.
No.
Anywhere from 2 to 12 hours a night with no discernible pattern. I'd wake up crying without knowing why.
The hell?
Sometimes I couldn't even open the bathroom door. I had a lot going on during the pandemic. My dad passed away from an unrelated illness, and lockdown was driving me mad.
Yeah?
I'd always been a bit paranoid, but being locked inside turned it all up to 11. My home was converted into a makeshift prison, an asylum where I was supposed to be my own caretaker. I didn't have much trouble switching to remote work. I usually worked with exclusively overseas clients anyway. But the only thing that really changed was the software, the chair, and my pre-rendered background.
But yo!
As days turned to weeks, it became increasingly obvious that I wasn't okay. I'd sleep anywhere from 2 to 12 hours a night, with no discernible pattern.
Feel that.
I'd wake up crying without knowing why. Sometimes, I couldn't even open the bathroom door, as I tricked myself into believing there might be someone on the other side. Having lost my dad, I was feeling more mortal than ever. The news, the internet, and the radio were all saying the same thing. Going outside was the end. And at that time in my life, I couldn't handle more death. Everything feels different when you're forced to stay inside. The walls seem closer, and your chest tightens. It feels like the air is thinner, warmer. You can feel your breaths enter your lungs, but they don't sustain you. Your knickknacks and doodads look like souvenirs from a place you can't go back to. A mockery, like notches on a prison wall. What was going on? Waking up, the nightmares would fall on me like a rock, knocking the air out of my lungs. I'd grow increasingly scared of going to sleep, as if that rock would grow heavy enough to crush me. And yet, it was all better than going out there, among the others. I couldn't take a step outside my door. Even if the lockdown was to be lifted that same day, there was no way for me to convince myself that everything was going to be fine. Nothing was fine, and it wouldn't be for some time. My colleague, Dana, was the first to take notice. I'd been up for about 53 hours. She called me into a chat after a remote meeting, telling me I looked sick. I melted. I poured my heart out about anything and everything, barely forming a coherent sentence along the way. If someone asked me to recall what I said that day, I could only hazard a guess. Dana tried to understand, but must have realized this was above her pay grade. I get it. It's a lot right now. It's a lot for all of us, she said. It might be time to talk to someone. She reminded me that we had an agreement with one of our main partners, Patchett Pharmaceuticals. They handled our health insurance, which also included mental health treatment. In fact, they'd expanded on it since the start of... They got a remote counseling program, she said, holding up a brochure. Just use your company login and sign up for a session. What do you think? There wasn't much to say. I was willing to try anything. I filled out a questionnaire and got a response within a couple of hours.
Wild.
I sent a link to a calendar app and got to pick a name from a list. There were a couple of short descriptions by each available counselor, giving me a bit of insight into what kind of person they were. There was a man named Gareth who had an empty calendar. It was strange. Each counselor could be sorted by seniority and number of patients, and Gareth was at the top. He was, by a good margin, the most experienced employee. So how could his schedule be so empty? I signed up for a session with Gareth the next day. It felt like a stone settling in the pit of my stomach. I was nervous, and I didn't even know why.
Man.
It scared me. Or maybe it was the thought of opening up to a stranger. Either way, it affected me way more than I thought it would. I went back and forth on cancelling the whole thing.
Yeah.
I wandered around like a cat on a hot tin roof.
Yeah?
Feeling the walls closing in.
Whoa.
I ended up on the floor, gasping for air, curled up like a ball. I just wanted it to be over. I took a day off work to have my first session. It was just past lunchtime. I prepped a cup of Earl Grey and a microwave cinnamon bun as comfort, but that wouldn't stop my hands from shaking. I got a pop-up on my screen with a blue sunflower logo. Clicking that connect button felt like dipping my heart in ice water. Gareth popped up in a little video feed. He was a man in his late 50s, with combed back salt and pepper hair. He had bushy eyebrows, a trimmed goatee, and a white shirt with a black tie. It looked like he was in a large office with wide, open windows. It looked pleasant, airy. Good afternoon, he smiled. I'm glad you can make it. It's difficult to take that first step on a new path.
Wow.
It really is, I nodded. But I'm glad you did, he said. Now, how about we talk a little bit
about spreading your butt?
Would that be alright? we took turns talking about ourselves. Okay. We shared our names, our professions, our age, and a little bit about our families.
Hey!
Gareth was 57 years old and had worked as a mental health professional for 23 years. He had two sons who lived in Philadelphia, just like my mom. We spent some time talking about how we adapted to the pandemic and how we felt about having to stay inside, wear masks, and the way it affected the way we looked at other people. I barely noticed it, but Gareth had accidentally made me reveal my issues without me even realizing it. He was good. Real good. I had told him about how difficult my life felt, that I felt trapped in my own home, but that the outside was even worse. You're describing it like you're sailing on a frying pan on a sea of fire, Gareth said. Like there's no way out. It must be stressful. He was spot on. I felt hopeless.
It was indeed.
I was spiraling down a black drain.
Stressful.
But he just smiled and nodded. We can work with this. I decided to see Gareth twice a week. I could book any time I wanted. His calendar was wide open. I wanted to ask him about it, but I didn't. There was a part of me who didn't want to get too personal. Gareth seemed nice, but he was also just doing his job. I was asked to sit by an open window during work hours as an exercise, a way to get used to the sounds of the outside world. It was nerve-wracking. Every passing car felt like a freight train, and every stray voice from a passerby felt like a threat. But slowly, day by day, it turned to background noise. And with that, the world started to feel a little bigger. The walls breathed again. Over the next few sessions with Gareth, we tried a couple new exercises, leaving the window open while I slept, leaving the front door unlocked during work hours. And by our fourth session, he asked me to try something new. About half an hour a day, right before you go to bed, I want you to open your front door, he said. Stand or sit there, taking in the sounds of the city. That night, I tried it. I opened the front door and sat down. I tried to mentally record everything I saw, one thing at a time. The walkway down the road, the ill-kempt playground. I counted the cars, the windows and the nearby buildings, the light posts, the parking meters. I put some conscious thought into observing things from a new perspective. But through it all, the one thing that made me want to go back inside was the sight of other people. It wasn't just a threat of a spreading pandemic. People seemed nefarious to me, ill-willed, dark silhouettes roaming about in the night. Their wants and haves a mystery.
Damn.
If the news were an indicator of anything, everyone was struggling to make ends meet. Everyone was a potential assailant. At best, they were indifferent. Perhaps I had it all wrong. Maybe it wasn't the virus closing my throat that was the greatest issue. Maybe the real problem had been people all along. Looking at the nameless shapes staring at me from the windows across the street, that sentiment felt more true than ever. The more sessions I had with Gareth, the more I realized my priorities were changing. I was letting go of my claustrophobic tendencies, but I couldn't help but to feel threatened by the people around the neighborhood instead. Gareth seemed very interested in this, asking me to describe my feelings and mapping out my day. It was very thorough, and I got new exercises to deal with my anxieties. I was asked to record my nightmares and worries. Another day, I was asked to write down stray thoughts on paper. Another, we had a session about how to practically deal with intruders and how it made me feel that there might be people out there who wanted to harm me. We talked about the many ways people could disappoint you, and how easy it was to retreat from the public. But I didn't get a good read on Gareth. It seemed to me like he wasn't really trying to treat me anymore. The exercises he suggested did little but to zoom in on the worst feelings that lingered in the back of my mind. My anxieties were emphasized, not examined. But one thing that remained was my nightly routine to sit with an open door, looking out over the neighborhood. I'd stopped mapping the objects I could see, instead focusing on the neighbors, strangers walking past in the night. I convinced myself that they wanted my money, my car, my brand name clothes, all of it. I had this feeling that if I were to leave my place for a night, I'd come back to it being ransacked. If I came back at all, it was easier to just stay inside.
Damn.
One of those nights, however, I saw something. On the other side of the ruined playground, there were a series of row houses. One of the doors were left wide open. I could see the shape of someone standing in the doorway. I could have sworn they were looking straight at me. They didn't move. Were they trying to figure me out? Was this a warning? Over the next few days, I couldn't stop thinking about this potential someone. It's as if I could see them everywhere, and Gareth wasn't helping. He was asking me to describe them, both physical attributes and their actions. It became a bit of a hyperfixation, and I couldn't stop myself from seeing them in the corner of my eye. But the fact was, something was happening out there. I'd see that same person every night, staring at me from across the street. I'd hear footsteps outside at night. Sometimes when I slept, I swear I heard someone messing with my letterbox. It felt ridiculous, and I knew I was exaggerating. But was it really all make-believe? It was a Tuesday when, once again, I logged in to have a session with Gareth. The weather was rough, and some construction work had cut off my high-speed internet.
Bitch!
Mobile Wi-Fi, and the approaching storm didn't help. Gareth connected, but it took a bit longer than usual. He had the same half-smile as always. I noted that he seemed to have good weather, which was a bit of a surprise. I thought he lived in the area. "Mr. Martin," he said, "I'm glad you could join me." I froze. I checked my webcam, making sure it was working properly. The resolution was a bit spotty, but there was no question about it. My face was clear enough. "My name's not Martin." Not only should Gareth know that, but he could also see and hear me. It was very strange. I was caught off guard. "Of course," I said. "Wouldn't miss it." Gareth sat completely still, looking straight ahead. He was silent for almost a full minute, then sort of sprung to life. I thought that maybe the storm was interrupting the Wi-Fi, but it seemed to be working fine. Maybe there was an issue with Gareth's calendar app. Then again, if it was the case, how come he didn't recognize me? "Have you been keeping up your exercises?" he asked. "Yeah," I said. "Yeah, I have." "So, let's hear it then," he continued. "What did you learn?" "About what?" Gareth leaned back in his chair and chuckled. It was a warm sound, but there was something hollow in it. The screen froze, and in a heartbeat, he was back to leaning forward, looking straight into the camera. "About your target." I barely had to say anything. This Martin person had come to Gareth for an issue similar to mine, something he had diagnosed as general anxiety disorder. It seemed like Gareth had poked and prodded Martin in a way that focused their issue on an external threat. Other people. A neighbor. I stood up, stepping away from my laptop, but leaving the conversation running. I peered out my living room window. Well, what do you think I'll do to this neighbor? I asked. We've talked about this, Gareth responded. I know, I repeated. But I want to hear what you think. I'm afraid you might murder them. I looked back at the screen. Gareth just stared straight ahead, not moving a muscle. No motion. Just a matter-of-fact statement. I felt the moisture on my tongue evaporate as something sour crept up my throat. And what do you think about that, Gareth? I asked. He didn't blink. A full 20 seconds of silence passed. The only sound I could hear was my own heartbeat. I think you're going to do what you need to do to heal, he said. And I want you to heal, Mr. Martin. At any cost? Of course. There were a couple of people outside, passing by in the night. Someone with a thick coat, another with a trucker cap, one with a backpack, another on their phone. Some with their hands in their pockets, someone holding something dark. A gun, a knife. But no one stepped up to my door. No one came knocking. There was someone standing in an open door on the other side of the playground, looking my way, like they'd done so on so many other nights. Maybe they were making a difficult decision. The meeting with Gareth ran out of time, and I dove onto the net. My hands were shaking so much I could barely spell. I checked it all. The name of the program, the pharmaceutical company, Gareth, everything and anything I could get my hands on. There wasn't much to see. Paper trails came to sudden ends. Names were scrubbed or removed. Most people working on the platform were hired as outside consultants. And there was no way to trace what kind of money they were moving, or where. And Gareth, he was a puzzle piece. For everything he told me, none of it was specific enough for me to look up. There were no names of his children for me to track, no address where he lived, no mention of his previous place of employment. Running out of options, I called up my colleague, Dana. It was 11 p.m, but I had to get answers. Dana was skeptical, but she could tell I was upset. She wasn't enthused about getting back in front of a computer, but I got her to look up a couple of things. It didn't take long for her to find something curious. Thatcher has a company policy about billable consultant hours, she said. They have a maximum number of billable hours. If someone goes past this, they need to be hired as a full-time employee. How does that relate to their remote platform? Gareth and a handful of others go way above this average. They ought to be full-time employees, but there's nothing that says that they are. So they're bending their own policy a little? So what? There'd be a paper trail, she continued. We have a close association with them. We got access to their meeting protocols. Policy exemptions need to go through the board. So the only way I see it, there is only two ways to make sense of this. She took off her glasses and leaned into a camera, lowering her voice. Either this program is run illegally, or these people don't exist.
Go lay down.
I thanked Dana and got back online. There was no way I'd be sleeping that night anyway. A stray thought hit me, and I got back on the calendar app. Even now, in the middle of the night, Gareth was available. I booked an immediate meeting with him. That gave me an idea. Using my phone and a separate login, I checked his calendar again. According to it, he was free, despite me having booked that time already. So, I booked him again. Two calls at the same time. And at the same time, a connect button popped up on my phone. I clicked both buttons at once. Gareth popped up with the same smile as always, sun shining from his open windows. Good evening, said Gareth on my computer. Everything all right? Asked the Gareth on my phone. There were two of them. They were talking at the same time. I turned off my phone and leaned back. My pulse was rising. I had no idea what I was even looking at anymore. I've been paranoid about people for weeks, maybe months, but there'd been a mystery in front of my face all along. You're not real, are you? I asked. Of course I am, he laughed. I'm right here. Is this what you need to discuss? Are you having issues separating fantasy from reality? No, I spat back. No, you don't get to do that. I'm not imagining this. And I don't know what to say, he shrugged. I'm as real as can be. I'm right here. Then how come you're saying two different things on two different screens, Gareth? Gareth didn't answer. He looked off screen, as if considering something. He looked back up at me, still smiling. I'm sorry, he said, but I have an urgent patient issue that I need to resolve. My laptop shut off. Seconds later, my phone went black, and someone was coming up the stairs. Before my heart could skip a beat, something slammed into my front door. I raised my arms as if to shield myself from the sound. A second later, I heard the hinges buckle and snap. Then, something broke. Something splintered. I rushed to my kitchen, passing the entrance. There was someone standing by the broken door. I only saw them in passing, dressed in dark, ill-fitting clothes. Grabbed the first sharp thing I could get a hold of. Armed with a kitchen knife, I backed myself up against the wall, knocking over a few doodads in the window. It was a long way down, but if I had to, I'd rather have a shot at breaking a leg than dying. But I couldn't get the damn thing open.
Oh, fuck!
Okay. A stranger stepped into the hallway. About 6'3", dressed in a navy blue hoodie and a black leather jacket. Leather gloves curled around an honest-to-God machete. A face obscured by a burlap sack with holes poked out around wide-open green eyes. Shoulders heaving with excited breaths. He rushed forward, grabbed one of my kitchen chairs, and threw it across the room. It broke against the wall, knocking over a photo. Shattered glass covered the floor. Something whistled past my left shoulder and slammed into the kitchen tap with a metallic clang. It made my ears screech. I steadied myself against the kitchen table, and it was casually tossed aside with a crash. I headed straight for the door. For the first time in months, I didn't consider my anxieties. I had to get out. Then, something cold grabbed my neck. Leather gloves. I reached back with my kitchen knife, but lost my footing on the broken glass. I was sent tumbling to the ground, landing hard on my shoulder. I looked up to see a raised machete and those sparkling green eyes. I had to say something. Anything. Mr. Martin? It was the first thing that came to mind. The machete hung in the air, ready to fall. He hesitated. You're Mr. Martin. You're speaking with Gareth, right? There was no response. Just excited, heaving breaths, and a shaking machete. frozen in place like a living statue. He's tricking you. Us. He's tricking us. He's not real, Mr. Martin. He's not real. Something clicked. A heavy boot stepped on my wrist, kicking my knife away. The machete crept closer, cold steel resting on my chin. I felt the warmth leave the tip of my fingers. I win, a hoarse voice wheezed. I got you first. I'm not playing any games. I'm not. For the first time, he blinked. He tilted his head. I continued. I'm not playing, Mr. Martin. You can't be first if I'm not playing. You were trying to get me first. No, I wasn't. You're lying. The tip of the machete pushed into my skin, shaving a couple of hairs and cutting a 2-inch gash across my jaw. Pain, like sharp ice, spread across my face. Then, noise. A loud, electronic noise. My phone. It must have come back on. Martin stopped. He was having trouble hiding his glee. He was giggling like a schoolboy. This was funny to him, if anything. Answer it, he chuckled. I want them to hear. I took my phone out. It was Dana. Answer it, he repeated. Put it on speaker. So I did. Dana's voice came through. Something about what we talked about had kept her up as well. She'd always been the kind of person who couldn't let go of a good mystery. You gotta hear this, she said, going straight into a rant. I think I got something. I held up the phone for Martin to hear as Dana explained her findings. It turned out the program wasn't supported by our healthcare deal. It was just registered as a support feature, and it was included in the same paperwork. It was never literally spelled out as a health service. Looking into the fine print, it was specified as a technical support feature. You get it? She laughed. They're not a mental health care provider. They're hired to handle data collection. What? I whispered. They're gathering data. That's their primary function. Data like mental health problems, stress-related issues, ages, locations, trends, dreams, wants. Or how fast they can get us to kill one another. Dana laughed. I looked up at Martin. He wasn't laughing. The machete pierced my phone as he flicked it across the floor. His eyes sunk. He didn't look as excited anymore. His shoulders slumped with a heavy sigh. You're not playing, he wheezed. No, I'm not. He took his foot off my arm. I could feel the warmth running back into my fingertips. With a casual stroll of someone heading to the supermarket, he headed for the exit.
Fuck.
Without looking back, he shared a few parting words. I would have won. Over the next few days, we lost access to the program. Dana and I couldn't do or say anything. Turns out they had baked more than we'd anticipated into the terms of service. It explicitly stated that it was an experimental service and wasn't to be used as a substitute for conventional mental health care. It was all just data collection. Some artificial program meant to get people talking, engaging them, and pushing them to tell more and more and more.
God.
Anything to help them or guide them, but to get them to return, talk, and stay engaged with the platform. And this Martin guy? Turns out, there was no neighbor with that name. There was, however, a man who'd been found dead in the row house across the street. Slashed to pieces, and kept in plastic bags in the bathtub. Someone had been squatting there since the beginning of the pandemic. Someone who the neighbors described as a strange man with bright green eyes. I think Gareth was just keeping this murder engaged, poking him to go further, to do more, and to stay occupied. I don't think it was a conscious decision. It was just algorithms. Oddly enough, I think my paranoid tendencies have eased. As the pandemic came to an end, I figured something as absurd as this whole thing won't happen to the same person twice. No matter what I run into out there, I don't think it's going to be another killer. It's freeing in a way. If I can survive this, I can survive anything. Unless Mr. Martin thinks I'm ready to play.
Are you fucking serious? Are you real? Fuck me, bro. All right. Me when I'm trying to figure this shit out. Hey, fuck you. You've got to be shitting me.
Do I need a repeater? Oh, fuck off. Get out of my house. I'll sick the entire fucking dog army on you.
I climbed out of the car and stretched, looking around at the endless expanse of forest surrounding me. The only break in the sea of trees was the wooden fire lookout tower ahead, protruding above the canopy. My back twinged a bit as I arched it, my boots scuffing the gravel road as I stretched my legs from the long drive. The air was cool and fresh, so different from the stale city air I'd grown accustomed to over the years. It felt clean and pure in my lungs as I took a deep breath. My eyes settled back on the fire tower, and a grin spread across my face. This was it. This was what I'd dreamed of for so many years. Solitude and nature, along with the responsibility of protecting this part of the forest. I slung my backpack over my shoulder and started up the narrow metal steps leading into the structure. The sound of my footfall.
That's another one, okay.
Nearby trees. Halfway up, I paused and looked around at the vast expanse of wilderness surrounding me. I'd never seen a forest so big. It seemed to go on forever in every direction. An overwhelming sense of smallness washed over me, and I shook my head, continuing up the steps.
If you've been injured in a car accident, don't call an attorney. Use this AI app instead. That's what I did, and it's how I got this $100,000 check in less than 30 seconds. I know it sounds crazy, but trust me, if you've been injured in a car accident, I'm about to turn your world upside down. So I was in a car accident a few months ago. My car was totaled, and I ended up...
Shut up!
The truth is, behind closed doors, the P word became my secret sin at age 10. And for the next 17 years of my life, what I did in the incognito tab made me feel like a hypocrite.
Shut up.
A calming sense of smallness washed over me. I shook my head, continuing up the steps. At the top, I dug the keys I'd been given out of my pocket and unlocked the door, pulling it open on squeaking hinges. The interior was small and Spartan, consisting of a bed, desk, and some shelves. A large map was tacked to one wall, and windows lined all four walls, providing a panoramic view of the sea of trees below. I dropped my backpack to the floor and looked around the room, taking in my new accommodations. The furnishings were all well used, but appeared to be in good shape. As I inspected the desk, my hand snagged a piece of paper partially hidden beneath a coffee mug. I unfolded it curiously and saw it was a handwritten note, the paper yellowed with age and the ink faded somewhat. As I scanned the note, I shook my head in amusement. It was some sort of list of rules for staying in the tower. Things like, make sure all the lights are out by midnight. Don't answer the door if someone knocks after dark. If you see lights in the forest at night, don't look directly at them. And other such nonsense. None of it made any sense, and I laughed as I read through them. It had to be some sort of joke, some way to haze the new guys and inject a bit of fun into an otherwise boring rotation. I was still grinning as I folded the note back up and set it aside. It was pretty amusing. I had to give them that. I wondered briefly about the lookout that had been here before me, the one that had written the note. Who were they?
Fuck!
Were they sitting right here at this desk, giggling to themselves as they made up these ridiculous rules? With a shake of my head, I dismissed the note from my thoughts and continued unpacking my things. I was anxious to get settled in and start my new assignment here at the tower. As I went about my task, I couldn't quite shake the feeling of eyes on me, but each time I looked out the windows, I was met with the same empty and endless forest. The sun dipped low in the sky, casting beautiful shades of orange and red across the landscape as I found myself sitting at the desk, writing my second log entry for the day. The silence up here was nearly complete, only occasionally interrupted by a gust of wind through the trees or the cry of some distant animal. It was serene, yet it set my nerves a bit on edge for some reason. By the time I'd finished unpacking my gear, night had fallen over the forest, and the trees outside swayed gently in the cool breeze, black silhouettes against the starlit sky. I marveled at the sheer multitude of stars in the sky, so many more than I was accustomed to back in the city. The air was fresh and clean, and I took a deep breath of it as I moved back inside, closing the door behind me. For some reason, I felt a bit exposed with it open to the outside darkness. My eyes flicked over to the note again, and I smirked. Yeah, okay, I said aloud, mocking myself for the unease I felt. Very funny. Still, as I busied myself by organizing the few supplies I brought along into the small pantry closet, I found my gaze drawn to that list of rules more than once. Before long, it was nearing midnight, and I found myself yawning. I grabbed a bottle of water from my backpack and walked over to the open window, gazing out into the darkness and listening to the stirring of the forest around me. It was certainly peaceful out here, I thought. Peaceful and safe. I looked at the note again, deciding to play along and close the window, latching it before moving to each of the others and doing the same. The last window secured, I turned back to the room, my eyes scanning the now darkened interior of the lookout station. My hand reached out and flicked the lights back on, pausing for a moment as I remembered the first item on the list. I hesitated for a moment, thinking about it more. It was dumb, leaving the lights off. If there was any danger of ambush, it would have come while I was securing the windows. Besides, there was no reason to believe anything about the note I'd read. It was probably left here by my predecessor as a joke, a way to screw with the new guy. I didn't move from my chair, but my heart continued to race. The knocking came again, a little louder this time. I found myself holding my breath, listening for anything else. The darkened forest outside was silent. My gaze flicked back to the note on the desk, and I cursed aloud when I read the second rule again. Don't answer any knocks at the door after nightfall. This was stupid. It was probably just a branch blowing against the side of the tower. But it sure as hell didn't sound like that. It sounded too measured, too deliberate. I stood from my chair and moved over to one of the windows, peering as best I could into the inky blackness and trying to keep as much of the window frame between me and the glass as possible. The darkness was complete, and I could see nothing. The knocking stopped briefly, and I thought I heard a sound, carried almost imperceptibly on the wind. It was a moment before I was able to make it out. David, let me in. I staggered a step backwards, away from the door, almost falling.
Damn.
You don't know my name. It must be someone from the ranger station coming out to check on me. But why so late? And why didn't they just say so? The knocking came again, louder this time, and somehow different. Like it wasn't knuckles rapping on the door anymore, but something else, something harder. The door shook under the assault. I was as far back in the corner as I could get, eyes wide and fixed on the door as it seemed to sag under the relentless pounding. The metal hinges groaned under the repeated blows, and I thought they might tear free. The hours dragged by, but they seemed endless. All the while, the knocking never stopped. At times, it lessened to barely more than insistent drumming of fingertips, while at others, it grew to a wrathful barrage that reverberated through the entirety of the tower and threatened to shake the very stones loose. Throughout it all, I dared not move, dared not speak, dared not even dream of opening the door. Shortly before the sun's early glow began to paint the eastern sky, it abruptly stopped. For a moment, the absence of the constant rapping was so sudden that it was almost as disconcerting as its presence had been. I stood there and listened, straining to hear any hint of motion beyond the portal. I slowly approached the door as quietly as I could. Grasped the handle, certain it was going to suddenly start turning on its own. With a final steeling of my nerves, I snatched the door open as quickly as I could, ready to confront the nightmare that had been scratching to get in. But there was nothing there. The wooden landing and steps below were as empty as they had been the day before when I'd made my way up here. The gray light of morning illuminated the fog-shrouded trees surrounding the tower, chill droplets of moisture condensing on the walls and railings. I slumped against the doorframe, body sagging from the rush of adrenaline and the unexpected flood of relief I felt in that moment. Was I losing my mind? Was this some sort of hallucination brought on by my isolation and the power of suggestion from those insane instructions? I found myself standing at the open window, staring out at the stars in the sky.
Fucking hate redstone.
The forest was an endless mass of shadowy forms, swaying gently in the light breeze that drifted through the window. It was so quiet, almost oppressively so. I thought back over the last few weeks I'd spent up here, with the odd occurrences, the strange and paranoid rules that the previous lookout had left behind, and the ever-present feeling that I was not alone, that I was constantly being watched. I'd followed the rules as best I could, as crazy as they were, but the isolation was beginning to take its toll on my mind. I often wondered if I was beginning to lose my grip on reality. The cool air smelled of pine and loamy soil, and I took a deep breath, letting it fill my lungs. David.
Earn up to $130 for your first two plasma donations. With flexible hours.
Did you know you can get brand new permanent teeth in just 24 hours? Did you also know it only takes 60 seconds to find out that you qualify for those teeth?
Bro, that's crazy. I still have my teeth, though.
It tells you if you qualify for their... ...and fill my lungs. David. Bang, bang. Louder this time. My heart froze as I heard the voice, my mind reeling. It couldn't be. It was impossible. Dad? I asked, barely able to force the word from my lips. Yes, David. I'm here, son. It was outside, somewhere in the dark, open air beyond the tower, and it sounded like my father. The same warmth in his tone. The same gruffness. But my father had been dead for several years now. My hands clenched the edge of the windowsill as the remembered warning raced through my thoughts. Don't respond to any voices you may hear, even if they are familiar. But this was my father. How could I not respond?
Daddy. Okay, anyways.
The plaintive words pulled at my heart, and I found myself moving towards the door before I stopped myself. This wasn't real. It couldn't be real. That wasn't my father out there. Why won't you answer me, son? The voice sounded closer now, with a hint of frustration. I backed away from the window, pulse racing so fast and hard that I could hear it, feel it, in my ears and throat. David! The word was a bellow, and I started at the sound of it, hearing the flapping of wings as a flock of birds was startled from a nearby tree. I rushed to the door and tripped over my own feet as I staggered forward, grabbing the knob and frantically turning the deadbolt lock with trembling fingers. Oh, David, let me in, son, please. I'm cold. I'm so cold, David. I leaned back against the door and slid down to my ass, tears coming to my eyes as I listened to my
father's
cries to open the door, to let him in, to help him. Everything in my body wanted to open the door, to do what he asked, but the part of me that still held on to rational thought kept me where I was. You're breaking my heart, the voice said, sounding as if it was on the verge of tears. I didn't raise you this way. After all I've done for you, and this is the way you treat me? I pushed my hands over my ears, anything to drown out the terrible words, but they seemed to somehow slip past my fingers and directly into my brain. I'm so very disappointed in you, David. I didn't raise you to be like this. The recrimination hurt more than if he'd reached through the door and struck me. I bit my lip hard enough to draw blood as I fought the urge to cry out. It must have been hours, though it felt like days, before the light through the windows began to fade. All the while, the voice had continued, sometimes pleading with me, other times accusing me, all the while manipulating my feelings as deftly as a veteran puppeteer working a marionette. I stayed huddled against the door, keeping my hands clamped over my ears as best I could, rocking gently. It wasn't until I saw the dim glow of dawn light beginning to seep through the windows that the voice stopped its haranguing. The abrupt transition to silence startled my frayed nerves, and I remained frozen in place, too terrified to move, too terrified to make a sound. Only when the sun had fully risen did I dare straighten my cramped knees, my entire body trembling and my muscles burning from the adrenaline and from holding my position for so long. My voice croaked as I drew in a deep breath. I wondered if I'd been screaming during the night, although I couldn't recall. Slowly, I crept to one of the windows and risked a quick glance outside into the forest beyond. The morning seemed peaceful and calm. Birds flitted through the trees, small rodents scurried about the forest floor, and a light breeze swayed the branches of the trees. There was nothing amiss, nothing out of the ordinary, nothing to indicate that anything had been wrong at all during the night. I raised the binoculars to my eyes, my heartbeat quickening with fearful anticipation. For a long moment, I saw nothing but the shapes of the trees silhouetted against the starry sky. But then I caught a glimpse of something blue. Refocusing the binoculars, I saw it again. In the far distance, amid the trees, the unmistakable colors of blue flames suddenly sprang into being, their ghostly light illuminating the nearby trees. As I watched, paralyzed by the sudden terror that gripped me, I saw shadowy forms moving within the fearful glow of the hellish fire. They were tall, impossibly tall, with long limbs that appeared to be grotesquely elongated and jointed in ways that defied logic. They moved with a fluid grace between the flames, and I could see no details of them other than the vague shape of their forms in the blue light of the fire. I shuddered involuntarily, understanding intrinsically that I was seeing something that no man was ever meant to see. This is what the rules were in place for. This is what the secret of the forest was.
Meh.
One of the shapes stopped moving and slowly turned towards me. Even though I couldn't make out a face, I could feel its eyes upon me, and the dread and fear that washed over me threatened to drive me mad. My trembling hands dropped the binoculars to the floor of the lookout with a clatter. I stumbled backwards, my hands shaking as they fumbled to set the radio back on the desk. My heart pounded in my chest, and it was all I could do to catch my breath as I backed away from the window, straining my ears for any sound, any movement in the darkness below and around me. Several minutes passed while I stood there in the center of the room, my head swiveling from side to side and eyes scanning the dim interior of the lookout with irrational fear. What the hell was I doing? What the hell had I done? By the time darkness had settled completely, I was a nervous wreck, jumping at every creak of the tower in the wind, every rustle of leaves that drifted through the open windows. My mind was playing tricks on me, convincing me that something was going to leap through one of those openings and attack me. The afternoon sun hung high in the sky, its hot rays beating down on the roof of the fire tower as I sat in my chair, binoculars scanning the tree line and horizon for any signs of smoke. I had long since settled into the rhythm of the slow back-and-forth process, my glazed eyes threatening to lull me to sleep in my trance-like state. When the radio on my desk suddenly crackled loudly, I nearly dropped my binoculars in my surprise, my heart skipping a beat before it settled, and I placed the binoculars on the desk. Static hissed from the small black speaker, intermittent with brief bursts of garbled speech. I leaned closer, reaching out a hand to adjust the volume as I tried to make out the words through the distortion. My pulse quickened as I understood the words that were struggling to be heard through the distortion. Come home. Somehow, I just knew that was what it, no, what they were saying. An almost overwhelming compulsion tickled at my brain, urging me to press the transmit button and answer them. My fingers flitted to the key, shaking. I halted myself, remembering the note. You'll be tempted to respond. Don't.
Anyone with $10,000 or more in credit card debt or personal loans may qualify for help from National Debt Relief. Minimum payments could literally keep you in debt for decades. $10,000 in debt can take anywhere from 14 to 26 years to pay off if you're only paying the minimums. And that's just $10,000. I know many of us have a lot more than that. Getting started is easy, and the process has already helped over 500,000 people and counting.
I called immediately.
All right, so the big question is, in a world of unlimited distractions, where do we
find space? What the fuck? Speaking of unlimited distractions.
Don't. That's what it said. I knew it by heart, having read it so many times. I took a deep breath, willing it to be calm, and keyed the mic. Yeah, I'm here, I replied. I didn't bother to hang around and listen for a response. I reached over and shut the radio's power back off, relishing in the sudden silence, as the only sounds that remained were the gentle rustling of the trees in the afternoon breeze through the open windows. Even still, I couldn't shake the feeling of unease that had settled over me since I'd heard that voice. The hair on my arms and neck stood at attention, and I felt a chill, despite the warmth of the day's air. It was like something had been waiting just outside my tower, watching and listening, waiting for me to make a mistake. I turned as slowly as I could, searching the tree line around the tower. I could see no movement, hear no birds. Even the constant sound of the wind gently blowing through the upper canopies around me was gone. The silence was deafening, and I unconsciously held my breath, fearful that the sound of it would draw attention to me. Long minutes passed as I stood there motionless, eyes flicking from window to window in the observation level, desperately seeking any motion. Still, the forest remained silent and unmoving. Slowly, so slowly that I almost didn't notice it, the natural sounds of the forest gradually began to reemerge. I heard a lone bird call uncertainly from somewhere nearby, and another answered it. The breeze again stirred the leaves with its lazy breath, sounding very much like a long exhalation of relief. My own breath shook as it escaped my mouth, and I realized I'd unconsciously been holding it the entire time. My legs trembled, and I staggered to the nearest chair, dropping into it heavily. My racing thoughts began to settle, replaced by more rational, if no less concerning, questions. Who had sent the message? Why did they want me to go back inside? What would have happened to me if I hadn't listened? My eyes flicked over to the radio set again, sitting inert and benign on my desk.
A part of me considered flicking it back on again to see if I could catch the message again, but I remembered that irrational feeling of being watched and thought better of it. The sun had fully set, and I busied myself with my usual evening activities, trying not to think too much about the oddities I'd been experiencing over the past few weeks. I prepared a can of soup over the little stove and enjoyed its heat as it slipped down my gullet. The routine actions were reassuring in their familiarity, if only superficially. I was about to sit and write my evening log entry when something moved in my peripheral vision. Without thinking, I turned and looked out the window, my heart skipping a beat. A figure. It was manlike and taller than any person should have been. It stood motionless at the edge of the tree line, casting an ominous shadow in the dim light of the setting sun. My pulse quickened, and my mind screamed at me in panic as I recalled the advice about figures like this. Don't stare directly at them. With great effort, I tore my eyes away from the window and back to my logbook, my hand trembling as I gripped the pen and tried to continue writing. My shaking pen created only nonsense on the paper. For hours, it remained there. I didn't need to look to know it was there. I could feel it. Every bit of my body was taut and on edge, screaming at me to do something, to run, to look, anything. But I ignored it. I forced myself to go about my evening routine, washing the plate and glass in the small sink, wiping down the tiny counter, all the while almost painfully aware of its presence. By the time full dark had fallen through the trees and up the tower, it was still there. I could practically feel its eyes upon me through the glass, patient and still. My skin felt hot, my shirt damp and clinging to my body with sweat. My ears rang in the otherwise silence of the tower, only broken by the sounds of my labored breath. I was pacing the room, my strides coming in quick, uneven gaits. Every few minutes, I had to forcibly stop myself from turning towards the window, straining to keep my gaze averted from it. The compulsion to look was intense, growing into a physical pain in my chest as the hours ticked by. My body and mind alike were nearing their limits, and I felt myself beginning to flag from the long night. My eyes were gritty with fatigue, and still I dared not close them, dared not rest for even a moment. With the coming morning light, my fear only intensified. Soon, it would be impossible to keep from seeing it.
Man. Vision.
Then, just when I thought I could bear it no longer, when the first dim glow of dawn began to brighten the sky, I felt it. The sense of malevolent oppression eased and lifted with the coming sunrise. Tentatively, I let my eyes drift to the window once more. The dark figure was nowhere to be seen, and the tree line was peaceful and empty in the early morning light. I collapsed against the wall in relief, my head spinning. With trembling hands, I tore open the loose floorboard and reached into the dark hole beneath it, my heart hammering in my chest. My fingers brushed something solid, and I pulled it out. A leather-bound book, the journal left by the previous lookout. My hands shook as I unfastened it and flipped it open, the smell of age-yellowed paper rising to greet me. The initial pages were covered in handwritten notes about the local climate and various fauna he'd encountered, but after a few pages, the notes took on a more sinister tone. 47th day. The voices from the woods returned. I am unable to understand them, but I believe they were nearer today. 53rd day. Spotted shapes among the trees this evening. They were too high to be people. Remember the rules. Do not meet them with your gaze, finding it more difficult each day. I felt my breath quicken as I read. This lookout before me had seen the same things I had, heard the same voices, seen the same people in the woods. It wasn't just me. I scanned ahead to the next pages, my pulse racing as I read more of the entries, noting how they seemed to become more feverish, the handwriting sloppier and filled with more panic.
Bro, where the fuck the iron go?
Something knocked at the door last night, three times. You were right, Ranger. I didn't answer. Didn't sleep either. 75. Spotted the blue flames out there again. Closer than before. Could see the forms moving in the glow. Sweet Jesus. I came so close to meeting their gaze. My hands were trembling as I turned the pages. The last entries were haphazard and chaotic. 82. Broke a rule. Didn't mean to. Can't stand it anymore.
Man.
The whispers. The eyes. Always the eyes. I looked. I know I shouldn't have. But I did. They saw me. They know.
Are you drowning in payday loan debt? Have you taken up multiple payday loans and are unable to pay them back? Then listen to this message closely. recently announced payday loan forgiveness program is allowing Americans with payday loan.
I looked. I know I shouldn't have, but I did. They saw me. They know. Day 83. They're coming. I hear them. Getting closer. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. If you're reading this, follow the rules. Always. Don't make the same mistake. Don't. The rest of the entry was unfinished. A long ink line scrolling down the page, as if the journal had been yanked away from the writer mid-sentence. I looked at the last of the words, written with wide eyes and a chill in my veins. What had the lookout observed? What had become of them? I shut the journal, my heart pounding in my chest. This was no prank, no bullshit hazing of the new guy. Something out there in the forest was dangerous, lethal, was hunting. The shadows were growing long as the sun dipped below the treetops, the golden hour light glinting off the pages and swaying gently with the rhythmic swing of the tower in the constant light breeze. The blue flames. I spotted them again, springing up at the tree-lined margins of the clearing, and nearer than I'd yet seen them. My heart hammered in my chest as my eyes flitted from one to the next, all around the perimeter. As they moved and flickered, I thought I saw shapes begin to take form within them. At first, only blurry shadows, but gradually becoming more distinct as they inched closer. They appeared almost human, but somehow obscenely distorted. Their limbs were out, their joints at odd angles. Their heads were misshapen, their features indistinct. Their motions were fluid and unnaturally graceful. I knew I should look away. I wasn't supposed to look at them, but I couldn't pull my gaze from them. They sway and undulated around the firelight in their horrible dance, and I forced my shaking hand to retrieve the note from my pocket where I'd written their details. With an effort of will, I lit a match and touched it to the corner of the page. The paper ignited, and I watched in morbid fascination as it curled and blackened in my hand. When the last of the paper had curled black and crumbling into ash, I sensed a change. The blue fires guttered angrily, and the creatures froze in their movements. For an impossibly long second, one of them turned towards the watchtower, and I got the terrifying impression of a hateful glare from its otherwise featureless visage. I staggered back from the window, my heart slamming in my chest so fiercely that I feared it would throw itself from my body. Without realizing it, I'd retreated as far away from the window as I could get within the narrow confines of the watchtower, my eyes clenched tightly shut as I counted my heartbeats and tried to slow my racing breath. When I dared to open my eyes again, the window and the clearing beyond were empty. The blue fires were gone, as were the faceless horrors that had cavorted around them. Something in the air felt different, though, charged with a menacing energy that lifted the hairs on my neck and forearms. I collapsed to the floor, my knees trembling from the combination of relief and fading fear. I remembered the notes from the lookout before me. Saw shapes moving in the firelight. God help me, I almost looked directly at them. But I hadn't almost looked. I had looked. I had stared right at them, without understanding what I was doing. A sinking feeling filled my gut. Had I done the same thing the last lookout had? I don't know how many days had passed since then. They all seemed to run together as I fought to keep my grip on sanity up in this tower. Every night there were new sounds, new whispers, new shadowed forms that seemed to drift lazily against the direction of the wind that buffeted the tower.
Yeah?
And always that uncomfortable sensation of eyes upon me.
I feel that.
The voices on the radio seemed to be increasing in frequency, calling my name over and over. I did my best to ignore them and continue my observations, but I felt myself reaching a breaking point. I began to pace the interior of the tower, unable to shake the feeling of constricting walls surrounding me. The air felt thick and hot, and I was sweating. I kept glancing at the doors and windows, irrationally wishing I could assure myself they were securely locked, even though I understood they would provide little protection from anything that wanted to get in. More than once, my eyes drifted nervously to the tree line, and I spotted an oddly tall and slender shape at the edge of the forest nearest the tower. I forced my gaze away, my heart racing as I recalled the rules. Still, I was certain I could feel its gaze upon me, even as I turned away and looked elsewhere. David, crackled the radio, louder this time. I could hear the eagerness in the voice, almost a hunger. David, we're waiting for you. I pressed my hands over my ears, but it didn't dim the sound in the slightest. It was as if the voice was somehow emanating from within my own mind, and I stumbled back to my cot, falling onto it as my heart raced in terror.
If you've been getting scam texts like these, it means your data was probably leaked online somewhere. Now, most of you can probably spot these.
Wow. 5D
is just a means to get closer to the truth about I. Every last one of these kids hates losing. I'll show you what I can do. I'll do whatever it takes.
Brazy.
All out there on stage. I'll use everything within me.
Don't worry.
Back to my cot, falling onto it as my heart raced in terror. No, I couldn't stay here. I had to leave. Whatever was in those woods, whatever had killed the last lookout, it was coming for me now. I needed to get out of here. To hell with the assignment. My hands trembled as I packed my bag, taking only what I needed and leaving the rest behind. I didn't care about the radio or the logbooks or anything else. All I knew was that I had to get out of here. As I moved, I heard the knocking again. Three slow knocks, just like in the directives. I stopped dead, my heart threatening to burst from my chest. And then it came again, louder. I didn't need any more motivation to continue my packing. The sweat dripped from my face as I worked with manic speed. But I couldn't just leave without warning anyone. Anyone who might come here in the future. I needed to make sure that the next poor bastard that drew this detail understood what they were up against, knew the rules. Even if I was too stupid to believe them, maybe someone else might take things more seriously. I left the note on the table where it would be easily found and headed out. As I reached the base of the tower, the knocking was replaced by scratching and something else, something that sounded like a low growl from deep in its chest. I didn't slow down, didn't look back. I just got the hell out of there and ran straight to my car. The trees seemed to lean in close to me as I went, their outstretched branches like grasping fingers. The windblown leaves seemed to shout my name now, a constant susurrus of sound that beckoned me to stop, to turn around. I dared not pause, dared not hesitate. If I did, I knew it would all be over. My white-knuckled grip on the steering wheel never lessened as I navigated the narrow, tree-lined road that led away from this cursed place. My heart still thundered in my chest, competing with the rushing sound of blood in my ears for attention. It wasn't until I reached the edges of the dense forest that began to thin.
Fuck.
As I reached the more traveled roads.
Well, I'm glad I fucking slept right here.
To the point where I could think clearly. I'd done it. I'd abandoned my post, fled from my duties, and left my station behind. The weight of my guilt was nearly as overwhelming as my freshly rediscovered sense of freedom. I looked up into the rearview mirror, expecting to see nothing but the empty, dark road behind me. But my heart leapt into my throat when my eyes spotted movement at the tree line, directly in front of where the tower lay. It stood there, motionless, a dark figure among the shadowed underbrush. Even at this distance, I could feel its gaze upon me. Instinctively, my foot pushed the gas pedal further, and the engine complained at the sudden demand. Still, my eyes remained fixed upon the rearview mirror, watching as the figure slowly grew smaller with my retreat. The road had curved during my retreat, obscuring the figure from my view, but when the mirror next captured the road behind me, it had vanished. Even now, as I drove along the road leading out of this forest and into the fields beyond, a paranoid fear tickled at the back of my neck, and I had to constantly fight the urge to look over my shoulder, certain that I would find that dark figure with the glowing blue eyes behind me, reaching for me. The chill left my skin prickled and my hands trembling on the wheel. Soon, the trees began to thin, and I spotted isolated residences set back from fields separated by low stone walls and split rail fences. Street lamps appeared periodically along the roadside, casting their incandescent glow warmly across pavement, still shining from the recent rain. I welcomed their inviting light, so different from the unearthly blue flame of those witch fires. My mind reeled as the tires sang along the wet roadway. What had that been? Were those the spirits of the light-eyed things I'd seen cavorting around those mystical flames? Were they something else? Why hadn't they tried to stop me? The questions churned in my mind, but the one that rose to the top was the most troubling. I may have left the tower, but it didn't seem that the tower had left me. Whatever the hell was going on in that forest, it wasn't limited by physical walls.
out here.
Fuck, dude. Yep. Oh. motherfucker.
Wow, that's crazy how not worth it that was.
Brazy. Can anybody see my shit? I can't. I legit don't know. There we go. I'm just going to put this up here for anyone who wants it. Beautiful. All right. Fuck. guess it was in fucking render distance. I didn't know. Fucking douchebags. Okay, so I'm down some diamonds. It's cool. Nothing I can't get around, but it's just annoying. Am I down both my pickaxes, bro? Gone. Gone. They're just gone. That's fucking awesome. Absolutely epic in every angle. Fucking way. Phenomenal. So excited about this, aren't you guys? Damn, I wanted a goddamn portal today. Now I gotta fucking spend it mining for diamonds, bro. Diamonds. Fuck. I shouldn't be mad, but I am. I'm about to say fuck it and just go take a shower for a little bit. Come back and figure out what I'm gonna do. But first, I wanna go sleep in my bed so I don't go back to fucking spawn. Or that stupid tower. Stupid shit. Oh, fuck. Yeah, I'm gonna take it.